Greetings everybody from Stereo and Beyond, and welcome back to a new video. Today I'm going to share a new piece that I bought literally a couple days after shooting my 2021 room tour, and it's a separate power amplifier for the surround system. I was talking to you guys about it in a couple of videos. It was a long goal of mine. Don't get me wrong, I love the fact that some receivers are all-in-ones. In the receiver world, you have two sorts of receivers. You have the receivers which are a bit of an old-school style, which is just amplifiers that are split up on different channels, and you have receivers with actual mono amplification inside. That's actually how they did it in the olden days, and that's why all those receivers weighed about 50 to 100 pounds sometimes. But the 6000 series from Denon, I believe they still do it today, has mono amplifiers inside, so single amplification for the channels, and you notice that. You notice that when coming from a single board amplifier. I had a 4000 series Denon before, night and day difference. More power, more separation, everything. And I was happy. I did some calculations. I drove all 11 channels. And that's the main thing with receivers, because they don't give you an actual power rating for all the channels at the same time. Mostly two-channel driven. But they do that because when you're watching a movie, you don't actually use all the channels at the same time with the same amount of power. For instance, Atmos channels use way less power than the center, for instance. So it's not fair to say, my Atmos channels need the same power as my center, because that's not true. But still, power is handy and nice. But in my room, where I'm not, far away from my speakers, I have a lot of speakers. I did some calculations, and the receiver was perfectly capable of driving it, power-wise, without running out of juice or headroom. Because headroom is also really important for big action scenes and explosions. So you want headroom in your amplification. Same with music. And I always said, when I get a bigger room, I will at least for my front system get separate amplification. Because I got a really high-end center channel. All my speakers are high-end, even my sides, the DNAs. I mean, it's crazy that I use those as side channels. And I won't be using that when I set up in a new room, in a new house. But that's a long, long way away. Probably. But still, I want good headroom, good amplification. So I always wanted to get like a 7-channel or something like that, because going separate has advantages but also disadvantages. For instance, cables, equipment, all the extra stuff you need to worry about. And that is something that can drive you crazy. To be honest, the difference is there. Like night and day difference, but the difference is not as big as going from the 4000 single board amplification that the 4000 Denon had to the mono amplifiers that the 6000 used. So that is something. What do I notice? I notice more separation, more headroom, everything is better. Voices are better. It's just everything is better. But the best way to describe it when you're using a receiver with a single board amplification, it can sound congested, like everything is together and you miss that surround sound separation. But when you go mono amplification, same goes with stereo. I have used, well, a lot of single, not mono power amplifiers. But ever since I went in the world of Onkyo, which is, well, mono, separate power transformers, separate boards, everything. It's basically two mono blocks in the same housing. But yeah, I'm not going back. The new amplifier that if I will get a new amplifier, it needs to be such a high quality amplifier, or just dual mono one, because you get that big separation and that big sound stage, and for me that's really important. That's why I have big speakers. Personally, I couldn't do with bookshelves as my main listening system. I just couldn't. I've heard so many high-end bookshelves, but the way towers present a sound, you can only get it from towers. But I'm getting off topic here. So yeah, what did I get? Well, I got an Arkham P1000. Beautiful piece. I connected it with a mono aura cable. So when I turn on the receiver, the Arkham turns on. Works like a jiffy. I want to turn it off, it turns off, so that's nice. I did make my own custom cables, because I did use some cables I had in hand, but I wanted to use better cables and well, the right lengths, because I don't have so much RCAs, because it's a 7-channel amplifier. So all my lower channels, back channels as well, are covered with the amplifier, and the receiver is only driving the Atmos. Atmos channels. I would love to get like a, well, separate amplifier for the Atmos, so that I could get a real surround sound processor, something from Marantz, or maybe even Anthem, or something with Direct Live. But still, this is for now fine. I was also worried because the 6000 was getting really hot. So what I did is, well, that's my HTPC. I got some really high-end fans, computer fans, laid them on top of the heat sinks that are in the Denon, and oh my god, it worked really well. I actually felt like I got more out of the receiver, because heat and chips and circuits and electronics in general don't go well with each other. So I tried cooling it and it worked. Well, of course it did get hot, because all 11 channels were being driven, and I was not comfortable with it, because I would like for my receivers to last a long while, and the fans were absolutely inaudible. They were only running around 400-600 RPM, and they were really quiet fans, really high quality. You couldn't hear it, but the effect that it had, the temperature and the performance of the receiver is huge. So if you're using a PC in your system, I was just running from the back some PWM fan cables, extensions, and I just laid two fans on top of the heatsink assembly on the receiver where it's located. Worked like a jiffy. I only needed to turn on the PC, but it's also really strange, you can't hear it. So that's that. But cables. The cables that I am using are, of course, Summer cables. These are the cables that I made. I was planning on using really high-end interconnects, but I use Anthonol and it works fine. Cables were not that expensive to make. I believe for parts wise I paid maybe €5. The cable is cheap, but it's Summer cable. It's such a short end. I just wanted to get OFC copper, good insulation, properly build them, shield them properly, proper RCA connectors, and it's fine. It's a fine cable. Personally, I wouldn't use it with high-end equipment or longer runs, but for something like this, it's fine. I compared it to my higher-end short RCAs, and honestly, couldn't notice a difference because I was actually planning on maybe ordering a couple of those, but they weren't available, and this was really cheap for me. The most expensive part were all the connector ends. The RCA ends, the cables are the cheapest part, but yeah, worked really well. It sounds unbelievable. It actually has a couple of gain settings, so that's really nice. You can adjust some things, and I heard a lot of bad things about this Arkham. I don't know why. Of course, there is better amplification available, but that thing was around 2,2500 euros, dollars, pounds, whatever. New, not that long ago. It is from this century. But I was like, why are people shit talking it? It's not at the same level as its competitors that are way up in the price range. This is the more entry level stuff that Arkham makes. But if you try and find a 7-channel amplifier that's built properly, has a good big solid toroidal transformer inside, yeah, those are expensive. But I mean, it's perfect fine amplifier. I didn't pay the new price for it. I actually got it at a really good deal. And I'm happy with it. I don't see a reason why I should ever upgrade from this thing. Maybe when I get the opportunity later on, I would love to get like a Macintosh surround amplifier. But before I do that, the stereo system is going to get upgraded. So it's probably not going to happen. But still, like, there is a sort of cult online. If you search this, a lot of people compare it to the Arkham that is 2 times the price, way more power, all that stuff. Yeah, it's I think even class A. So yes, it sounds different because it's not a class A amplifier, but I digress. So what I'm trying to tell you here is, if you're searching for a good quality 7-channel power amplifier that is capable of driving low impedance speakers, because a lot of my speakers are 4 ohms, it's a really fine amplifier. Just make sure you use good cables, set the gain properly, and you're off to the races. I do not get any hiss or anything like that from the speakers. It's a good quality piece. Properly built, it has good heat sinks, it doesn't get hot. Arkham uses switching technology inside. I'm not a electrician or anything like that, or electromechanic. I know my basics, but I really haven't dived into the way they made it. But it's an efficient type of design, so it shouldn't use like power all the time like a class A amplifier does. It's not class D either. I do not like class D with my speakers. Class D can be really nice in a home theater situation, but with my speakers and my type of sound, class D won't cut it. But in a lot of receivers nowadays, they do use it. And sometimes even class AB in receivers, I've heard. But still, it doesn't really matter, because a lot of people like class D. It's more of the professional side, because it can output a lot of power. But I don't think this is a class D piece. I think it's more of a house design that Arkham did. It can't really be defined as a class. Simply because, well, it does have a big toroidal transformer, big parts, all that stuff. So it's not class D, because class D doesn't need that stuff. It's not class A either. It's not class AB. So what is it? like you have infinite amount of classes in Amplifier. I've even heard, but that's more anthems type of thing, class H and all that stuff. But anyway, tech and specs are nice. Sound quality is the main thing that you want, of course. And I can tell you that this thing is probably good, and I really do recommend it. But yeah, some things had to be moved, so that thing is now over there. DVD player, which I am trying to use as a CD player, just with internal DAC and all that stuff. It was actually a top model of Denon, the DBT-3033UD something something. Haven't really played with it at all, but still. Other stuff is still over there. Yeah, what else have I been up to? Well, not much. Changed some things in the HDPC, new processor, some other fans. Optimized some things in the BIOS. All that stuff, all the good stuff. And well, actually, it really does change the sound. And I, well, still believe, even more so now, that a good setup, HDPC with, well, good quality streaming service with a good quality DAC, is the best source out there. You can get vinyl to sound better, I believe, but that would require such a high-end turntable setup with everything that is really complicated to achieve and to maintain as well, because turntables need to be cleaned, cartridges wear, records need to be cleaned and are of good quality, don't have scratches or dirt in them. Then you have the phono preamp and the settings on the phono preamp, which sometimes need tinkering with. At least in my case, I have a my funny story actually. My cartridge doesn't know what kind of cartridge it is. It's a bit confused. It's a moving coil, but it acts like a moving magnet, power and setup wise. So anyway, doesn't really matter. But still, those are things, you know, that are difficult. And well, same thing goes with the computer, but that's mainly just set it and forget it. You need to know the settings, you need to buy the parts and configure it and build it and do all that stuff to it. Same with the DAC. You need to, well, look at the type of DAC you want, all that stuff, and connect everything and set everything up properly. But if you do that, you will get a really high quality source signal from it. Way better than CDs with a CD player or cassette, tape, all that stuff. Vinyl could sound better, yes. Tape is a thing that's, in my opinion, a bit different, because tape is really heavily dependent on the same thing as vinyl, but even more at the bottom of the source, looking at the quality of the tape that is used. Are the heads clean? Is everything running correctly? All that stuff. Still, a lot of maintenance. That's why I prefer digital. Still do have a lot of analog music and all that stuff. Probably in the next video, I'll actually go over records that I have. Show you a bit of records and show you some records that I really like, really love. That should be interesting. That's it. Actually, I do not have anything else to say. Yeah, the cabinet is a bit damaged because I was experimenting with some isolation, and the Ulbach like absorbers that I have under my center channel as well really help with the sound, at least from my Onkyo. So maybe I will try them on those. Not sure yet if I will do that. Probably. Still, it jiggles. Yeah, you can see. But yeah, it is a bit damaged from moving it in and out. I actually needed to repair it. Not the fuse. It was the relay. I needed to be cleaned. Every now and again, the left VU meter gets a bit wonky, and I have determined that's due to the relay. And lo and behold, new relays for these amplifiers are there, but are expensive. It's cheaper to just get them out, clean it, put it back in, and it's good for a year again. So, yeah, old parts need maintenance. It's just like an old car. That's also why I love it. But yeah, good thing that this is just normal natural wood. I can sand it, and everything will be fine. But I don't really mind it. Gives us a bit character. Probably will do it though in the holidays, so when I have some free time on my hands. But I've been talking about everything here for the last 20 minutes. A lot of different subjects, a lot of different things to go on about. I'm actually figuring out some things about sound demos. I want to record music for you people and let you hear some of my, well, reference tracks and share new music, because I love discovering new music through sound demos on speakers on YouTube. If you have any tips or anything like that I could take an account when recording sound demos for my speakers, and let me know. I am not an audio engineer, nor do I think any are watching, but I think that it can never be a bad thing to know some more stuff, you know. Anyway, thanks for watching. I will leave you guys to it. Happy Easter. And yeah, that's actually it. I don't have anything else to say right now. Been watching some series, movies, all that stuff. Maybe I should actually talk a little bit about series and movies. Maybe we do a little bit of a, I don't know, weekly podcast type of thing. Maybe, perhaps, I don't know. Maybe, I'm working on some things that I want to do. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time. Goodbye.